This should be the final video in the series about adjusting your suspension on a bike like an Aprilia RSV4 RF1100. Now, I've already gone through videos in some real basics, beginner's level. I've gone through in all the adjustments I did trying to set the sag, including maxing out my preload in the front, raising the rear shock 3 millimeters. The last video was the one where I put the Fat Boy springs in the front of this thing. And so this one is now tying it all together and applying everything I've learned. Some of it will contradict what I'd said before, so this is the one you should pay attention to the most. And the links for all the other videos, as well as other things you may need to know about like front stand or wheel removal, those links are all in the description below for reference to make it easy for you to follow. Now, after putting in the new springs, I'm still not getting the sag number I want. So I talked to Mike at Kyle Race, and he pointed out that now my geometry's messed up because I got the rear end higher than it should, my angles are goofy, and so the first thing I need to do is put everything back to the sort of stock geometry and the damping settings where I want and get it to where the only real variable or the only thing we're messing with is going to be the actual sag, where everything's happy and where it should be to give me an accurate sag number so that I can set that properly now that I have the right springs and then get everything dialed in perfectly. Starting front to back to get all the adjustments right, the first thing is to set the preload properly. The thing I made a mistake before on is that I thought preloads were measured outward from bottom dead center like you're damping. That's not correct. The proper way to set your preload is to back them out all the way first. Now it's all the way backed out counterclockwise, so it's all the way up, which means you have no preload. And now I'm going to take my tape and I'm going to move that mark so that the little negative sign is right where the negative sign on the blue piece showing exactly where the negative is. So now I know when I'm always ending up in the exact same place. So it's an even number of revolutions. I'm gonna do the same thing on this side now. Now that one's all the way out. Put my tape right by the negative sign. All right, both the preloads are all the way out. The negative sign is labeled with the tape. Now I'm gonna move each of them 9 complete turns in clockwise.
Half. 1, 9. 9
exactly. So it's all the way backed out, and then 9 full turns inward. We're gonna do the same thing on this side.
9.
All right, both of them are 9 in from maxed out. Next is the damping on each of these. So I'm gonna start by turning all the way in. You can hear it clicking. Okay, that's all the way in. I wanna look at my spreadsheet. Front, compression and rebound. I want 18 compression and 20 rebound.
That's compression and that's rebound. So I'm gonna go 18 compression and 20 rebound. 1, 2, 18. So there's 18 clicks out from bottomed out on the compression. Now the rebound is 20. So first I have to put it all the way in. Okay, and it's 1, 2, 20. So you have 18 on compression, 20 on rebound. The height of the forks in the trees is just like it came. It's 3 of the rings, whatever you want to say. That's the way I got it, so I'm leaving them there.
Now the rear compression and rebound were 12 and 14, but that was simply me messing with the rebound, trying to get it to behave decent when that wasn't really the problem. So I'm going to go back to the 12 and 16 that I'd calculated as kind of ideal starting point earlier. And that basically means from going 14 rebound to a 16, which means 2 clicks outward on that rear shock.
All right, we want to turn the rebound, which is black knob, out 2 more clicks from 14 to 16. There's 1, 2. Now the other change more significant is that link on the bottom of the rear shock. I'd extended that out 3 millimeters, which brought the back end up when I was trying to accommodate the fact that the front end had come up from adjusting preload before. So now that that should be happy, I need to put that back where it was originally, which means I need to take 3 millimeters out of that length right there. I won't spend the time on this video showing all the detail of doing that. If you need some help with that though, you can go in the links below and find the earlier video where I did adjust that 3 millimeters, and you can see how to adjust it back. The rear shock is now free from the top. I've got the bottom of it exposed, so I gotta loosen that bottom jam nut, and I'm basically gonna take 3 millimeters out of that. And now it's back to the 3 millimeter gap it was before I ever messed with this in the last video. Shock's all adjusted, everything's put back together. Standing back, gonna take it off of these floor stands, get back to ground level. Now before we check our sag, we gotta go through the checklist and make sure we have everything right. We have the height correct on the front and down here on the rear. We have the preload where we want it up here, where we've already checked and established it back here. We have the damping where we want it, front, and we have the damping where we want it in the rear. The next thing to do is take it out for a ride, get everything warmed up. Make sure you bounce on them a little bit, hit the brakes, get the fluid moving through the suspension system so that it gets a little heat to it. The fuel tank is just a little bit over half, so that's good. You want it about half, so it's spaced in the middle. Again, I'm not going to go into all the details in this video, but if you need a refresher, check in the links below for previous videos. But you put in the front stand, lift the front end up, measure the fully extended length as I showed in the other video, write that down.
Now, the right way I was told to do this is technically it would take 3 people to do it. Me on the bike in full gear weighing it down, a second person holding it perfectly vertical, and a third person doing the measure. In the previous video, I showed the sag being measured on the stand. But the right way to do it is to have both tires on flat level ground and perfectly vertical as you would be riding. Makes sense. Why would you adjust something anyway except the way it's going to be when you're riding? So having it up on the stand wasn't technically the right way. So I'm going to try to make sure I'm doing it closer to correct with both tires on the ground and the bike vertical. Now, I'm just one person, so what I'm going to do, as opposed to having another person to hold it, is I'm going to use the wall right here, and if I lean the bike up against the wall, it's now perfectly vertical, with both tires on flat level ground.
You'll notice I'm leaning the bike to the right. The reason for that is I can use the kickstand, so just in case it gets unstable and it falls this way, the kickstand will catch it, versus if it were the opposite.
Right, static sag. Everything vertical, 96.2.
That's 29.46 static sag.
Now for the rider sag, we're going to take 2 measurements and then take the average of those to figure it out. The first one, you're going to bounce down and then just let it come up. And the second one, you're going to start and get on real gentle and just let it slowly come down. Don't move a lot, don't shake it, just let it slowly go down, and there should be a gap between those two, and in there is where we'll take our average.
Again, go reference the old videos in the links below if you need to reference how to measure the actual length on these. .78 was the number I got when I bounced on it hard and let it come back up. 85.13 is what it was when I gently sat on it. So you can see there's a pretty big difference there. And when you average that out, according to Excel, you get an average of 43.91 for a sag. Now, according to the OHLINS book, they want you at 41 sag, and I'm close to 3 over that. So what I can do to adjust this is turn in my preload 3 turns because it's 1 turn per millimeter, and that should put me right at 41.
Half. 1, 3.
I put both of them 3 full turns inward from where they were, which means they're now 12 total from backed out all the way, 12 turns in. And that's pretty close to where they were when I bought the bike. So I'm gonna try that, see how it works. I am about 4 to 5 pounds heavier right now than I should be. So that may contribute as well. So I'm gonna go ride it, try it out, lose my 4 to 5 pounds, and then I'll go through this procedure again and see if I can adjust these back at all or not.
Now that the sag should be properly adjusted with the preload and all those other things, the next thing to do is to actually go ride it. So I'm gonna take it out. The thing I wanna be careful of is I wanna watch and see, is it too cumbersome to push into a turn now? Because by adding a little bit of preload in the front, I kicked my rake out just a little bit, and that'll make it a little bit less responsive. I hope it's not too much that makes it, you know, hard to turn, but that's something I wanna watch. So go out and try it this weekend, see how it rides, lose my 4 to 5 pounds, and then go through this process again and just make sure I'm keeping it tuned into what's proper for my size. And the other thing I probably need to do is get somebody over here to actually help me do this properly with multiple sets of hands, just to make sure I'm getting all the measurements perfect instead of doing them by myself. But this should at least get me close to where I need to be.
For the ride, you want to push the zip tie all the way to the top. And now that I'm back home, I can see that it didn't come anywhere near bottoming out. Granted, this may have not been the most aggressive ride with cold roads and cold tires, but I'm still well ahead of bottoming out, so that's a huge improvement over before.
And most importantly, the bike felt awesome. Going through those high-speed sweepers, no instability, I cannot believe how 3 millimeters of difference on that rear shock jacked with the geometry so bad to make it handle that way. Yes, I should have swapped those springs a long time ago instead of fighting with it all this time, but it handles great now, and that's what's important, so better late than pregnant. Subscribe to my YouTube channel below and let's celebrate turning fuel and air into adrenaline!